Welcome to the Bulletproof Cashflow podcast, the go-to place to gain financial freedom through real estate investing. Here we interview investors, mentors, and entrepreneurs who share their secrets and advice to help you build passive income. Let's get into the show.
Hey everyone, this is Agostino. Leveraging social media is key when you're building your real estate business. To do it effectively, you need to get the most out of your social media by leveraging the right platforms and delivering the right content to each platform. So doing it right will yield more deal flow and get your brand in front of brokers and possibly even sellers. Well, today's guest understands the best ways to connect with millennials and Gen Zs. It can also piggyback off their relationship to connect with Gen Xers and boomers. As a social media expert and real estate agent, he was able to build a personal brand to get a great deal of success and deal flow in the residential space. Before this, he was considered becoming a pharmacist, but realized it wasn't aligned with who he was. So he turned to real estate instead and went all in. So today, he serves as the founder of Kingly Acquisitions, a Texas-based real estate investment firm that focuses on acquiring value-add apartment buildings. He hosts the Ronny Phillips Show as a creative outlet to inspire others and creates content that inspires people from all over the world. With all that, I'd like to welcome Ronny Phillips to the show. Hey, man, thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Thanks so much for having me.
Yeah, it's going to be great. Well, before we go on, if you like what Ronny has to say, check out his website at kinglyacquisitions.com. And of course, if you like our content, please don't forget to leave a comment and rate the show. All right, Ronny, maybe give the listeners a brief intro as to how you got your start in this whole multifamily business.
Awesome. So let's piggyback a little bit to how I got started in real estate. So I started off in residential real estate, 2015, fresh out of college. I was 21 years old. And then, you know, after going through, you know, a lot of different things, I went from, you know, selling houses as an agent to flipping houses. And then I realized there's no really end game to it. There isn't really a way to create true wealth by doing that. So in 2017, I formed Kingly Acquisitions, my commercial real estate investment firm that focuses on acquiring value-add apartment buildings. So from there, you know, what do? To get started in multifamily, we can educate ourselves, like listening to podcasts like yours, going to conferences, you know, finding different mentors, meeting up with people. So I started doing that. And then when I started Kingly Acquisitions, which was June 2017, it took me 18 months to do my first deal. So that 18 months, wow. What that looked like? It looked like going to every meetup I could in Dallas, every conference. I even volunteered to do due diligence for a couple of sponsors, and I did close to 3,000 units in due diligence, just site visits, unit walks, lease audits, all that. So I really got proficient in that. And then obviously have a show as well. So I wanted to create a platform that can help others, you know, in sharing their story, just like what you're doing with this podcast, right? So started using that platform as a way to put myself out there more, and definitely, you know, worked and whatnot. And then December 13th, 2018, put two deals under contract in Atlanta. So I partnered with a few guys, Ben Suttles and Ferris Musa. They're with a company called Disrupt Equity out of Houston. And then another guy named Mark Kenny with Think Multifamily, and put two deals under contract at the same time. And it was kind of crazy how we pulled it off, but we had to raise $9.2 million between both. So we raised on the first one, you know. So what is my expertise? What did I bring to the table? I had proficient due diligence experience. You know, I was pretty good at analyzing, underwriting, equity raising, marketing. I mean, those are all the skill sets I brought to the table. So that's how I got started in multifamily. Closed my first deal March 25th of this year. And then between my first and second deal, it was a 2.5 weeks. And then I just closed my third deal, 208 units in San Antonio on Friday. So currently I have 572 units in Texas and Georgia.
That's awesome. You know, before we talk about the marketing stuff though, I want to just touch on something that you had said. You volunteered to get that experience in doing due diligence, right? By doing due diligence. And that's actually a very unique way for people, for someone like you to actually help people, right? help a potential syndicator in terms of really contributing something to a deal when you're first starting out anyway, and for obviously no cost, right? You didn't charge them. You didn't say anything about doing any type of fees or anything else like that. You just want to get a look behind the scenes, right?
Yeah. I literally drove to San Antonio to volunteer for due diligence a couple times for a sponsor out there. And yeah, just volunteered my time and tried to help them. And coming from a place of contribution is key. So,
yeah, but I think it also speaks volumes as to your commitment to actually doing this. You know, many people, they'll say they want to do multifamily, for instance, or they want to syndicate deals, but they're afraid to even volunteer 2 hours of their time to even, you know, run some numbers where you're actually driving to San Antonio and you're walking a property. And that's the type of experience that most people charge for, you know, and you just did it. And you're fortunate enough to find, it sounds like anyway, you find a syndicator that was able to really support you with that. That's awesome. That's great.
Yeah. And what's crazy about that whole scenario is I went to, help due diligence. Guy named James Kandasamy with Achieve Investment Group. So he owns about 1,300 units in San Antonio and Austin. So he was the guy that really like taught me a lot on like boots on the ground stuff. I learned a lot from him. And yeah, I went and volunteered and did due diligence. And it's crazy, you know, almost a little over a year later, I'm closing my own deal in San Antonio, which is incredible.
That's so awesome.
It's like, talk about the power of immersion and visualization.
Yep. That's awesome. And of course, all through mentorship as well.
Yep.
So basically this gentleman acts like a mentor to you, right? That's great. That's awesome.
Yes.
That's awesome. So good. Tell us about this deal then. So the one in December with Ben and Mark and Ferris as well. So your contribution was to go ahead and get the word out there to raise capital, right? So maybe are you able to describe a little bit about what you did to really get this deal in front of people to help raise money and to really promote the property?
Yeah. So, I mean, there's many different ways and there's two different structures as far as going about this, you know, 506B offering and a 506C offering. So a 506B offering, you can't really advertise to the public, right? So, but with your pre-existing relationships, there's many different ways in adding value to that list, right? So our goal is to have strong relationships with our investors for them to come and invest with us. There's many different things. Like whenever I was wanting to get started in multifamily, I really wanted to know what was on site versus all these webinars and stuff, because I attend all the webinars and stuff. So what I did was I just got a vlog camera and I started filming like what we're doing for due diligence and stuff, and then sending it to our investor list with who we had relationships with. And I always ask my investors, what is the feedback you have? Like, what would you like to learn about deals, about this market and whatnot? Because a lot of people here, especially I'm based here in Dallas, a lot of people are buying deals in Texas, but we're going to Atlanta, Georgia, which is a whole different ball game compared to what most people are buying. So one of the very few sponsors I know that actually target that market. A lot of people are going there now. So that was one of the things I did, was doing a lot of videos, doing a lot of education on that market. And then there's like a 506C offering, right? So that's a whole different one, right? You can advertise publicly and you can pretty much do billboards, all that kind of stuff. So on that one, we did a 506C offering and just marketed it online. One thing I learned though is, like, just from my experience, the 506C offering, usually random people won't invest, right? Like say you're doing like a click funnel or something like that. So I'm all about building strong relationships with investors, and I'm blessed here to be in Dallas because there's like a meetup like every like couple days. But it's really getting feedback from your investor list, from people you meet, on what they want to see. So that's how I've been able to market to people as far as deals go. Also, like, not only doing the capital raising, because that's a whole different topic in itself, but there's a lot of other things you have to do on the general partnership, right? Like due diligence, underwriting, investor relations, all that kind of stuff. And all those, having a stacked value, it helps you bring more to the table than just equity. So that's something I always advise people on doing, is having multiple skill sets and complementary skill sets to a team.
Excellent. Excellent. And now let's take a step back for a second. When you were doing your videos then, you were doing this, was that before you actually started fundraising? Let's say, for instance, there's an asset in Atlanta that you're looking to get, for instance, would you just do video just talking about the area, talking about that certain zip code? Like, how would you do that? And what does the video contain? Like, how would you actually discuss what you are talking about? Like, what sort of key topics or what key data points are you hitting on when you're putting this thing on a Facebook Live or something?
Yeah, so there's different things, right? So on my YouTube channel, if you go to ronnyphillipptv.com, it points directly to my YouTube channel. So there is a video of me and Ben in a car. It's like 10 minutes, right? And it's talking about how we study submarkets to buy apartments. And then we're talking about Atlanta and why we like it and the key metrics as far as that. So that's one side, the educational side of the submarket. And this is just pure information to put out there. We're creating educational content. This is not to like say, hey, come invest in our deals. We don't like to roll that way. Our whole thing is like documenting the journey and showing people what this business actually is and what we're actually doing as sponsors. Because I feel like there's a lot of fluff out there with all these different like gurus and stuff like that. So we want to show people real life, real deal stuff. You know, another video we did is our plan was for value add, right? There's a lot of investors and people out there that don't understand how renovations and rehab can affect rents and stuff like that. So that was another video we created. So we walked a classic unit and we talked about, you know, what upgrades are doing, like, okay, we're resurfacing countertops, two-tone paint, you know, vinyl plank flooring, refacing cabinets, and then bumping rents $100. But some people don't know that. So we're just trying to show people the process of what we do.
Yes. And you know what though? And that's actually key, is to put that information out there and create a platform that educates people, not only things like this, podcasts and things like, really, I'm not going to say scripted, but you know, a Q&A type of interview, but also getting out there and showing, this is a classic unit. This is how it looks today. This is what the rents are. And once we go into this other unit, the upgraded unit, well, you can see the backsplashes, the faux stainless steel, all that fun stuff, the flooring. And it educates the audience and potentially a future investor with the quality of work that you're doing and will hopefully get them to invest in a future deal, maybe, right?
Yeah. It's all about providing value and having people reach out and having the opportunity to build a strong relationship with them.
Yeah.
I think that's really important because our investors are like family. You know, I was talking to one investor last night at like 10 o'clock at night. You know, these are the type of relationships I have with my investors. So that's why I'm looking to build.
Yeah. And I think that when you have that accessibility and you're able to provide value, I'm sure they're asking you questions about about a deal maybe, or about a future deal perhaps, but you're providing value. You know, you're actually being accessible to that investor, and they appreciate that. That's how they build trust.
Yes.
You know, like, ultimately, because just what you said a second ago too, with a 506C, we're just blasting out an offer. It's very hard to get the person who doesn't know anything about you to just slam down a couple hundred grand on a deal, right?
Yeah, and that's why it's important to build a brand.
Yep.
Because then they feel like they know you whenever you're going that route of a 506C offering.
That's right.
One thing I've learned though is just like allowing that to help you grow. That's another thing, right? Like, people may not invest in all the deals, right? That's why I have to specifically identify what your investors' needs are and then market that way.
That's interesting. So do you have an example that maybe you can share?
Yeah. So always with every investor, every time we close a deal, I said, what was your experience like as far as investing with us? Oh, it was great. We had the IMS system. You know, we're very accessible, all that. I was like, okay, I'm glad we did great. What some things we can improve on, because we're constantly trying to refine our process. They'll say like different things and whatnot, and everyone has different answers to it. So then I always make sure I take note of that and implement that next time. So it could be like, hey, I would love to see more videos of the property, or, you know, if there's opportunities for us to come shadow you or whatever. Like we took a trip to Atlanta, right? And one of my investors invest in these deals, and he's like, hey, can I come tag along and stuff? We're like, yeah, of course. We want to create the experience, you know, and then we flew out our camera guy to come film and whatnot. So it was a lot of fun. So that's an example of that.
Excellent. So are you also targeting certain investors depending on the asset class as well? I mean, is that ever happening, or are you typically buying the same asset over and over again?
Yeah, I mean, all our deals are pretty similar, B and C class value add assets. One common denominator is all of them have been, there's some sort of management play with it. As far as like specific type of investors, we like experienced investors and we like the new ones, right? So it's just really understanding what the dynamic is. Some people need more handholding than the others, and some people are like, hey, here's, they've invested us with before, don't really have much questions. You know, just basic questions here and there. So there's two different types of investors. So it's really making sure, like, for example, like the brand new investor, it'll be awesome to have, you know, a video library of different things like video updates and whatnot, right? But as far as the, for the experienced investors, it's good for them to have that in their back pocket. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So maybe share a little bit about your marketing thing. So you mentioned Facebook as a way, and YouTube, of course. So not, well, I guess not so much Facebook, but how would you market on Facebook versus a YouTube versus an Instagram? Do you typically put the same stuff out there, or do you chop up the data or the feeds? How do you actually do all that?
So as far as Facebook goes, Facebook is like the best way to connect with people in multifamily. There's a lot of different Facebook groups to be a part of. Everyone is on Facebook when it comes to multifamily. And it gets kind of overwhelming sometimes because there's so many Facebook groups and whatnot. So how I've been, I say, marketing on Facebook, I'm just taking people along for the journey. I think that's key, being transparent, being open. I'm thinking of the 18-year-old Ronny who wanted to get into a multifamily but didn't know how. Like, I knew what, but I didn't know how or who. So I wanted to be that person. In documenting my journey, like I literally vlogged how I bought my first deal from start to finish, from me signing my first Fannie Mae loan to, you know, closing the deal to like everything, right? So that's gonna be coming out soon on my YouTube channel.
Nice.
So there's different things like that. Instagram, same thing, you know, sharing different podcasts I'm listening to during site visits and stuff, doing like Instagram stories, like, okay, me and Ferris are walking a unit right now. This is what we're looking out for. Or like one of our value add deals in Atlanta. Okay, this is what a down unit looks like. Here's what the problem is, and this is how we're going to solve it, right? So you have to tailor it to each one. Like, for example, I think best way to develop relationships with investors is on Facebook because of the older demographic. Instagram is people like my age, mid-20s, right? So most of them usually don't have money to invest, but they will, right? So that's why it's important to put on both platforms. But I've seen people reach out on Instagram all the time, right? So it all depends on what the platform is. Snapchat, same thing. That's more of just like, if you're omnipresent on all platforms, people know what you're doing. And that's key. The people know, like, I've bought in Atlanta. People know I've bought in San Antonio. And then LinkedIn is like a new thing I'm stepping into. I'm still trying to master. So every time like I close a deal, I always post about it, tag all the people I partnered with. And then there's like my first LinkedIn post kind of went viral. I was like, I don't know, there's like 20,000 views on it. I was like,
wow.
I didn't know if that was normal or not, but I thought that was cool.
Yeah, it is pretty cool.
Yeah. That was kind of crazy. Well, another way I market is through the show, like the Commercial Cashflow Show, which is my second show outside of the Ronny Phillips Show. The Ronny Phillips Show is more of a deep dive interview on people's lives and inspiring stories. The Commercial Cashflow Show is specifically commercial real estate. I didn't name it the Multifamily Cash Flow Show or anything like that. I named it the Commercial Cash Flow Show because I wanted to keep it general. But most of our guests have been in the multifamily space. So it's like what you're doing exactly, right? Like you're creating a platform for other people to share their stories. That's very valuable, right? That's how you can connect with people and build relationships, right? With other sponsors, with past investors, with brokers. So that's another way I market.
Excellent. Excellent. So now let's say, for instance, with Facebook, we are doing our videos and we're putting out great content in terms of what's a down unit, what's an upgrade unit looks like, all that fun stuff. On Instagram, it's going to be a little different. Just like you said, a younger demographic, they may not necessarily be investors today, but they may be investors in the future, right? What sort of things do you do for them then? Do you just put up memes? Do you just do shorter clips? So what sort of things do you put up there?
It's more of like short, like 10-second clips on my story, right? Like of me walking a unit or, oh, I'm, you know, watching a webinar and about a submarket or, you know, different data points. Like, for example, Fannie Mae just redid their caps for next year, right? So posting that on my story, right? There's a lot of things that people don't understand. There's a lot of moving parts. I think the gurus make it seem really easy to do a multifamily deal. But once you actually do one, I'm on my third one, there's a lot you have to learn and know about this process. So I think it's really taking people along for the ride on Instagram is key. And that's more like a kind of like vlog style. It's less like, you know, official, I think, unless you're posting. I'm talking about stories and, you know, going from there, right? And you have to tailor to your audience. I get so many messages almost every day on Instagram and Facebook on, oh, how do I get started and stuff, right? So there's like a kid, he just graduated high school and he's like, hey, Ronnie, I want to get started in multifamily, but I'm 18, like what do I do? And I literally gave him like a huge paragraph on what he should do, right? And that helped a ton of people, right? Because I knew when I was 18, I was him 7 years ago. I'm 25 now. So I think I just saved him at least 5 years of his life just by writing that one paragraph.
Absolutely.
And then using my show as a platform to help them learn. That's been the key to marketing, is tailoring it to the audience.
Yep, absolutely. So now, what do you put up on Snapchat then? Because I know Snapchat, like you said, it's even a younger demographic, typically not too much real estate that I can see discussed on there. But what do you see on there, and how do you reach those sorts of people, and why?
Honestly, like I just post the same thing on my story on Snapchat and Instagram. That's it. Like I literally go on Snapchat, create a story, download it, and then upload it to Instagram.
Interesting.
So there's no real strategy there. I think people communicate differently on Snapchat. Like, for example, some of my friends will message me on Snapchat versus texting them because it's like less formal. That's like a whole millennial thing that I don't understand, but I see a lot of my friends do that. They'll just message me on Snapchat.
That's so funny, isn't it? So strange. But same material though, right? Same material, same thing.
Same material, like literally the same thing. Like there's nothing different because it's easy to copy one from the other because the way it's set up and stuff.
Yeah. So do you find you get the same sort of response on Snapchat then as you would with Instagram?
So not everyone has an Instagram and not everyone has a Snapchat. So I do have different audiences in both. That's why it's important to be omnipresent on all platforms.
Yeah.
Yeah, everyone reacts differently and stuff. I think a lot of people are moving towards Instagram now versus Snapchat, but there's still a huge audience for Snapchat because I've been using it for probably 7 years now. Like it was like whenever it first started, like I was in high school or something, you know, so I continue to use it every day, you know, so.
Wow. Nice. I know you're digging into LinkedIn as well, which is a great place to really interact with the older workforce type of crowd as well. Probably not nearly as flashy and as, shiny, I guess, is probably the best way to do it, as like, say, a Facebook or a YouTube, based on my own personal experience. I mean, there's people that I follow, for instance, that, you know, on their YouTube channel, they may say and do different things that would be very risque on a platform like LinkedIn, even though it's basically the same sort of people, right? But they may tone down the swearing or not swear at all, for instance, or they may even say or do different things, right?
Yeah. LinkedIn is a great way to connect with people. It's like a professional platform. You're not going to find a lot of like out there kind of stuff. It's very well polished. So you have to be careful what you post on LinkedIn. I'm not really an expert in that one yet, but I've made a lot of great connections on LinkedIn. So it's really been helpful in connecting with other lenders, other sponsors. Like, for example, I go to a conference, right? Usually I add people on LinkedIn first before I add them on Facebook.
Yeah.
But Facebook is like, it's kind of like where everything's at though.
That's right. Have you had any experience with any other social media platforms? Any ones that are coming out of the what's coming category, I guess?
So I've seen a lot of people starting to use TikTok, but I have no clue how I'm going to implement that in like my business. But I've seen that's a platform that a lot of people are getting on.
Yeah.
But for now, the main ones, the heavy hitters, Facebook, YouTube, Snapchat, Instagram.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, I find the same thing. TikTok is the new up and coming platform, which for those of you guys that don't know what it is, they're very, very, very short videos. I guess it depends on how long the video is, but typically it's, you know, 10 seconds, even less sometimes. Centered, in my opinion, mainly around comedy or magic or things like that, unless it's something else. But I'm the same boat. I'm not entirely sure how to implement that in the field of real estate.
Yes.
All right, guys. Well, if you want to reach out to Ronny, you can reach him via his website at kingleyacquisitions.com. There are a lot of resources there as well for new and experienced indicators. Of course, don't forget to check out ronniephilliptv.com as well. Include a link in the description. Thank you for your time, Ronny. Greatly appreciate you having you on, man.
Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you for listening. We hope you enjoyed the Bulletproof Cashflow podcast. For more free podcasts, articles, videos, and resources, go to www.bulletproofcashflow.com.